Let's get into the word, shall we? Stand to your feet. You guys got your Bibles, get your Bibles. Some of you guys already got your smartphones out, so you're doing that with the Bible on there. It's all good. Let's honor the Lord together today. I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord in prayer together. Father, we're so grateful as we come into the house of God today to hear your heart, God, to sit at your feet and just connect with you. Jesus, we love you. We're so grateful for the sacrifice that you gave on Calvary's hill, God, that you would go to the cross and suffer and die, pour out your blood for us. Lord, we're grateful people. Today, God, as we approach your throne, God, we pray that you would speak to us. We didn't come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We came to hear from you. Be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives, Lord. And we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, today we would ask that you would come and open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, open our hearts to have the good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. God, we'll do our part giving you our interest, our attention. God, we know that you'll do your part coming and speaking to us and revealing your word, your will, and your way to us so that we can live the way that you would have us to in a lost and dying world. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. We would ask that you'd be amongst them as you are amongst us today. So we bless our Baptist brothers and sisters, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapel and Harvest, for Oak Valley, for The Way, Ecclesia, Trinity, Emmanuel Baptist, for Victory and the Assemblies and the Four Square denominations. God, we bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. God, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. God, we would ask that you comfort them, protect them, bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, and deliver them, Lord. May they endure to the end to the glory of God. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Today, get your Bibles out and go with me to Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Today, I want to talk to you about a subject called the path to a healthy life. Now, this can sound like a positive thinking message. This can sound like a current topic in our society about physical health. But I want to tell you something about when we talk about health in the Bible, really, it's talking about the whole man. It's talking about, yes, physically, but also spiritually, emotionally. It's talking about health in your family, health in your finances, talking about health in your relationships, health in your witness, health in your testimony, health in every area of your life. When God saved you, he saved the whole man. Spirit, soul, and body. He has bought the whole thing, right? He has redeemed us. He's even quickening our mortal bodies. Even though we're going to get a new body someday, glory to God. We're so thankful for that because we know these ones are wearing away. But did you know that the Bible says that he has saved your whole man? That's why by his stripes you were healed means the whole person. Means that you were healed of your sinful backsliding, you were healed of sin, you were healed of sickness, you were healed of distress, you were healed of all those things. God has saved the whole man. So when I say the path to a healthy life, I'm not just talking about physically. I'm not just talking about, nutrition and diet and exercise, all that kind of stuff. What I'm talking about is your entire person. We see this in the book of Hebrews, the 12th chapter. We've been in a section of verses talking about discipline. And then we come to verse number 12 and verse number 13. And it says, therefore, in other words, because of the discipline of God, there has to be something that takes place. Therefore, strengthen the hands which hang down and the feeble knees. Now, last time we were together, Pastor Luke brought a great message about being resilient. Remember, he talked about bouncing back, that no matter what life throws at you, that you are going to stand back up and stay strong in the will and the way of the Lord. It goes on to verse number 13. It says, and make straight paths for your feet. I want you to notice that this is all connected, that this is one sentence, this is one breath, one thought from the Word of God. And it says, and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be dislocated, but rather be healed. And there we have it, the path to a healthy life. Now, we all know that the shortest distance between two points is what? A straight line. We all hopefully learned that in school. I know we are in the California education system, so some of you guys might have missed that week. But the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. Now, the quickest way to go from a disobedient, carnal Christian to being a healthy, strong Christian is to shape up and to follow the way of the Lord. So here God gives us the path to a healthy life. Think about it like this. A path is something that you know that you can travel on, right? If we were to go up to the mountains, we could see that there are different paths that would take you up to the summit of the mountains. Now, yes, you could just go straight up the side of a mountain. You could make your own path. You could blaze your own trail, that sort of a thing. But during that time, you could end up twisting an ankle. You could end up falling off a cliff. You could end up in a bear den. You don't want to do that, right? And there are all sorts of trials along the way. Or if you stick to the path, you'll make it to your destination. And here God says, I want you to make straight paths for your feet. Really, the idea is of going over the same thing again and again and again until you carve out a channel that you can easily walk on. I think about it like this. What if every day you had the newspaper delivered to your house? One day you got a new delivery boy that came by on his bicycle. And rather than throw the newspaper up to your front doorstep like the other guy did, now this one is kind of lazy and he just drops it there at the front of your yard. And so you're there in your house and you go, oh, I got to go get the newspaper. So every morning you get up, you come out your front door and you look across your lawn and there you are and you say, well, I'm going to just walk straight across the lawn. You go down, you pick up the newspaper, you stand up and then you walk straight back. Now think about if you did that every day, week after week, month after month, year after year, what would happen to your lawn after a period of time? You would literally have a dirt path going through your grass. Why? Because you have trampled it every day going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. That's the idea that we get from the Word of God, to make straight paths for your feet. In other words, there are healthy things that we can do, healthy routines that we can do as Christians that will wear out a path so that we can make straight paths for our feet so that what is lame may not be dislocated, but rather be healed. In other words, there are things which are hanging down in our lives. There are hands which hang down. There are actions and things that we need to get busy with that we shouldn't have our hands just hanging down by our sides, but rather we need to lift up our hands in praise. We need to start to lift up our hands to do the work of the Lord. We need to lift others up with our hands. We need to encourage others and strength, and we need to reach out to people with our hands. We don't need to let them hang down. Also, the knees, you remember Pastor Luke was talking about this, that those knees which are weak, right? The knee is the strength. See, anytime you talk to a Christian about their knees, most of the time when you say, Christian, hit your knees, what are you talking about? In prayer, right? So we need to strengthen those feeble knees. We need to get in prayer. We need to have a healthy habit, a healthy routine. Every morning when you get up, the first words off your mouth would be, thank you, Jesus, for another day. This is the day that the Lord has made. I shall rejoice and be glad in it. Father, I approach the throne of grace. Today I need you, Lord. I need your presence in my life. I draw near with full assurance of faith because I know that as I draw near to you, that you're drawing near to me. God, I pray for your help today. I pray for your strength. We need to pray. We need to strengthen those feeble knees. We can't back off our prayers because our prayers is what sustains us. Our prayers is what maintains us. Our prayers is what rearranges us. Our prayers is what's going to change the world around us because we can't do it. We need the Father to move on our behalf. So we need to lift up those hands. We need to strengthen those feeble knees and we need to make straight paths for our feet. We need to get into those healthy habits, those healthy routines, praying and reaching out, getting into the Word of God and the spiritual disciplines, coming to church. We already read in the book of Hebrews that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as is the habit of some. See, there are some people that come to church on average once a month. It's pretty sad. That means that path has not been well worn. That path, they're probably going to twist an ankle on the way. That path, the devil's going to throw something at them, knock them off if he has the opportunity. Why? Because they are weak and they haven't made straight paths for their feet, and as they walk that path, they might get turned out of the way. They might be dislocated. They might not be a healthy Christian. There are things in our lives that we have to get to. And today I was praying about this and thinking about this. I believe the Lord revealed a couple of things that if we're going to make straight paths for our feet, that there is a path to a healthy life for us. A couple of things that I want to talk to you about today, that if you will incorporate these things into your life, if you will do them, then you will make those straight paths. You will wear out that path until you have something that is smooth, that you can go back and forth on, and that you can be healthy and strong as a Christian. Are you listening today? First one is this, is that you need to remove your foot from evil. We're going to get onto a straight path. We got to remove our foot from the crooked path. Is anybody listening? See, in our society, in our day and age, evil is celebrated. Several of the most recent movies that I have watched have been evil people doing evil things, but because their motives were the right way, they celebrated those individuals and exalted them as good. The world calls evil good and good evil. And when anybody stands up for their morals or their beliefs, especially when it comes to the things of the Bible, they are told that they are a hater and that they should stop being such a bigot and that they should sit down and be quiet. And yet God has not called us to sit down and be quiet. God has called us to stand for what is right and to remove our foot from evil, to call good good and evil evil, to call a spade and to stop messing around and playing games and to stand up and be the church. And the church should not be operating in the wicked ways of this world. We need to remove our foot from it. There should be a difference about the church. We should be standing in the way of the Lord. It is the highway of holiness. God has not called you to uncleanness. And we know what's bad. We know what's evil. And yet, many times we find Christians standing in the way of the sinner, walking in the counsel of the ungodly, until we're eventually sitting in the seat of the scornful. Psalm 1, verse 1. We need to remove our foot from evil. C.S. Lewis said this. He said, "We all want progress. But if you're on the wrong road, progress means doing an about turn and walking back to the right road. In that case, the man who turns back soonest is the most progressive." I was out hiking one day, and I knew that I was supposed to get over to a certain direction, and so I started looking around and heading, actually I was heading east. And as I was heading that way, I was up on these ridges and these hills, and so I figured, okay, I'm just going to go east up over this hill, and I was on a trail. And as I came over the hill there, I came to a dead end. And I looked, and I could go down into a valley and up over and find the trail on the other side, or I could backtrack. And so what did I end up doing? I ended up going all the way back, all the way around, until I finally found my destination. See, the sooner you realize your position, the sooner you realize, listen, I'm on the wrong road, the sooner you repent, and repentance is so simple. It's a change of mind. It's a change of direction that you go 180 degrees away from the way that you were going, and you go back God's way. See, true repentance always repents towards God and his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's where we as Christians have to realize, listen, we're all going to get off track at times. We're all going to get on the wrong road. There are things that are in our mental thinking that will take us in the wrong direction. There are things in the flesh, those sinful desires that will take us in the wrong direction. But the moment you realize your position, the moment you realize I'm on a crooked path and this is going downhill fast, then you remove your foot from evil. You turn around and you repent of the way that you were going and you turn back to God. You say, God, I'm sorry. God, cleanse me. God, here I am. I'm headed in the right direction now. See, the difference between the people like Esau, which we're going to read about in the book of Hebrews chapter 12, and the people like Saul, the first king of Israel, and the difference between them and a David, or them and Joseph, or them and someone else, is that they had a heart that stayed after God. They had a heart that removed their foot from evil and went back and repented and followed the Lord. Same thing with Peter in the New Testament. You find out that there were times that Peter did the wrong thing. He stuck his foot in his mouth. He cut someone's ear off. He ends up sitting with the Jews rather than the Gentiles. He's confronted. But listen, that man never got off Jesus. He repented and he kept following the will and the way of the Lord. Are you listening today? Proverbs chapter 4, turn there with me. Back into the Old Testament, Proverbs chapter number 4. And in the Greek version of the Old Testament, Proverbs chapter 4 contains some of the same language as Hebrews chapter 12. Very interesting. I like the way it says it in Proverbs chapter 4. We're going to take a look at verse number 26 and verse number 27. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 26 starts out and it says this: ponder the path of your feet. In other words, think about where you're at and think about where you're headed. And look at what it says: and let all your ways be established. Established means firm. Established means that it is something that is sound, something that is solid. So when we think about wearing out, making a straight path, making a channel because it's been well worn, then we need to consider our ways. We need to think about our direction. We need to think about where we're going. And then we need to let our way be established. It needs to be settled in our heart. I'm doing what God says. I'm not going to go down the evil path. I'm going to go down the right path. So ponder the path of your feet and let all your ways be established. Verse number 27, do not turn to the right or to the left. Remove your foot from evil. See, God says, make straight paths for your feet. And now here we read, do not turn to the right or to the left. That we are to have a narrow focus, that we are to have a vision of what God wants for us, and we are to head in that direction no matter which way the world turns, no matter which way society goes, no matter which way our family goes. Listen, even if the church goes a different direction, but we know it's not the way that God would have us to go, then listen, I'm not going with everybody else. Right? If the church is going the wrong direction, I'm going to go in God's direction. Listen, if Pastor Dan ever gets off, you don't follow me if I'm not following Christ. Follow me as I follow Christ. But if I get off, you go follow Christ. Are you listening today? I know that might be new for some of you guys to think those things. But listen, if you ever hear something that you get a check in your spirit, you better go check it out with the Word of God and find out what God has to say about it. You follow God. You don't follow man. You follow God. Amen? I should have had a bigger amen than that. Come on, somebody. See, here's the problem. We want someone else to do all the work for us. Pastor, you tell me what to do. Pastor, you live my Christian life for me. You go ahead and be holy, and I'll feel good about that when I come to church. Listen, we are all in this together. I may be anointed to preach the Word of God, but I'm no more anointed to live it than you are. We all have to work at this. We all have to remove our foot from evil. Listen, I got to work at cleaning up my act just as much as you guys need to clean up your act. We are all on the road of holiness together. Hello. All right, we'll get you praising by the end of the church service today. Might be some omies out there instead of amens. Path to a healthy life, remove your foot from evil. Second one is to remember God's word. If we're going to make straight paths for our feet, we got to remember God's word. See, God's word is his roadmap for life. In it, he shows us both the path and the destination. See, we're headed towards heaven. We're headed towards eternity. But did you know that God will give you the steps along the way to show you? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, right? Jesus is the Logos. He is the Word of God. He is the entirety of the Word of God. And did you know that the Holy Spirit's job description is to remind you of all that which Jesus has spoken? Therefore, the Holy Spirit is the one who will bring back to your remembrance things that you have read in the Bible. The problem is, in order for the Holy Spirit to remind you of it, you have to have first read it. That means the more you get the book in you, the more the book can come out of you at the right time in the right way. But you got to give the Holy Spirit something to work on. When I was first saved, Brother Rick and Mona Mordoff right over here on the front, wave at everybody. These are my friends. Rick was one of my first employers, and I'm so appreciative of you. You put some work ethic in me, my brother, and I learned some hard lessons under that man. And just good to be in church with you guys. They're moving to Kentucky and breaking my heart. And so when are you guys moving?
As soon as we can.
As soon as they can. They're waiting to sell their house, right? We'll be praying for you to do that. But they're moving to Kentucky. They're riding horses and all that kind of stuff, which I guess Kentucky is the place to do that, the Derby and all that. But anyways, we were in a church when I first got saved. I was 15 years old, and we were both in the same church, conservative church there in Moreno Valley. And in that church, our pastor stood up one year, and he challenged the entire church to read through the whole Bible in one year. And he said, you read the Bible 3 chapters a day, 5 on Sundays, and you'll get through the whole Bible in a year. Well, we took that to heart. And in fact, Rick started a ministry called Know What Jesus Would Do out of that, where he has a year Bible reading plan that gives you a little bit of the Old Testament, New Testament, some of the Psalms, and that sort of a thing. Really a great resource. I think we still have that at the Information Center. Mignon's saying, yes, we got that for you today. If you want to get a hold of that, you can get a hold of that Bible reading plan. And January 1, start a good resolution of getting into the Word of God. Or 3 chapters a day, 5 on Sundays, you'll be done with it in a year. Here's the deal. I read through that, and I got done in 8 months. That's good, right? 8 months I was done because I just devoured the Word of God. But I got to the book of Revelation chapter 21 at the very end, and I read the amen, and I closed the book, and I looked up, and I thought, what on earth did I just read? And it's been a lifetime now for the past 21 years of my being a Christian that I have gone through the Word of God every year, and I've just kept going through it and kept going through it and kept going through it. See, what you're doing when you get the Word of God inside of you, you are building a library on the inside. That when you encounter situations, the Holy Spirit can go and he can pull out a volume. Oh, you need this from Ezra. You need this from the book of Ruth. Oh, you know what? You got to go back to Genesis for this one. And he will pull out those volumes and he will open up and reveal the word of God to you. He will speak a rhema revelation to your life at the right time in the right moment. But you got to get the book in you to get it out of you at the right time. So you need to remember God's word. Ed Stetzer wrote an article for Christianity Today citing a 2015 Lifeway research study that found that only 45% of those who regularly attend church read the Bible more than one time a week. Over 40% of the people attending read their Bible occasionally, maybe once or twice a month. And almost one in five churchgoers say they never read the Bible, essentially the same number who read it every day. Guys, we have a problem. We have a church who calls themselves Christians that has no idea what the Bible says. They started interviewing people in England that called themselves Christians. Now remember, England is a what they call a post-Christian, post-modern society, okay? And the people in Europe and in other places around the world view themselves as beyond Christianity. And they started asking people who called themselves Christians, who attend church regularly, is the Superman story in the Bible? And they said, yes. Guys, that is not funny. I know we laugh at that sort of a thing. That is not funny. That is sad. That's a crying shame. Started asking them, is the Hunger Games story in the Bible? And many people said, I think so. See, we don't know who Noah is. We don't know who Moses is. We don't know who Rahab was. We don't know who these people are. Many times we approach the Word of God and we think we know something, but we don't really know what we should know. And therefore, we've got to get into the book so that the book can get into us, so that at the right time, the Holy Spirit can pull it out of us. And the Word of God is what changes our life. Right behind Holder Crooks Park there at the end of Mountain View, there's a little trailhead right there, and you can go up into the hills back behind there and walk around. It's a really neat place. I enjoy going there. And the first time I went there, I noticed that there was a map right at the entrance. And so I took a picture of that map, and the whole way in, I was glued to my map. I was just walking, and I was, okay, 1.7 miles this direction, and you're going to hit this fork in the road, and then you're going to go left, and this and that. And so I was literally just walking through that place, glued to my picture of that map. And as I went through, I made sure that I found the different places that I wanted to go and found the ridges and all this and that, and went up this trail and this place and made it up and made it back. And so I started doing that regularly, and I started to learn that to where I didn't really need the map anymore. One day I decided to go in, and so I said, you know what, I've done this a couple times now, and I know my way around this. Maybe I'll do a new trail. Maybe I'll find a new spot because it's a pretty big area. And so I decided, you know what, I'm going to head over, and I'm going to go this direction. I'm going to head west and hit up Shotgun Ridge and some different stuff like that and find all these places and just see what it's like because I've never been through those trails before. So I start walking through, and I decided, you know what, I don't need the map. And I just started walking, and I started finding new places, and I kept going. And after a while, I was getting tired, and I realized, you know what, I'm kind of done with this hike. I think I'd like to be home with my children. I think I'd like to go sit on the couch and watch some TV. I think I'd like to eat some lunch. You know, I haven't really had lunch. I had a Cliff Bar for breakfast, and that's not too much energy, and I started wearing out. And after a while, I started realizing I'm running out of water, and I'm tired, and my hip flexors are hurting. My knees are starting to hurt, and I'm walking, and finally, I pull out the map, and I am so lost. I have no clue where I'm at. I know I must have walked probably close to Ritchie Canyon somewhere. I don't even know what was over there. I just knew I needed to head back, and so I kept going back, and I kept finding new ridges as I'm walking over places. I'm like, this has got to be the entrance. Then I realized, nope, this is not the entrance. I'm not where I want to be, and I kept going and kept going, and I wore myself out to the point where by the time I finally made it back, I was so done. I was like, I am never coming back here again. I'm just like sick of this place. I've seen all of it. I didn't realize it was that big. I didn't know what I was getting myself into. All because why? Because I didn't stick to the map. See, we've got to remember God's word. We got to make sure that we don't go off map. Otherwise, we'll get lost. We'll get weary, and things will hang down. Things will be dislocated and turned out of the way. Psalm 119, verse 49 through 56. I'm going to read this to you in the Message. If you want to follow along in whatever translation you have, you can. But I like the way that it said it in the Message paraphrase. Psalm 119, verse 49 in the Message says this. It says, remember what you said to me, your servant. I hang on to these words for dear life. These words hold me up in bad times. Yes, your promises rejuvenate me. Remember we said, make straight paths for your feet, that which is lame may not be dislocated, but rather what? Healed. We're talking about the path to a healthy life. The word of the Lord will rejuvenate you. It will bring life to your bones and health to your flesh. He says, the insolent ridicule me without mercy, but I don't budge from your revelation. In other words, you're not going to get me off of the word of God. I will be glued to the map. I'm not getting lost. I'm not getting off track. I'm not getting off course. I'm going to make straight paths for my feet. I will follow the word of God. You cannot get me to budge from it. He says, I watch for your ancient landmark words and know I'm on the right track. Jeremiah cries out to the children of Israel, to the nation, and he says, stand at the crossroads and ponder your ways. Think about your life. And he says, ask for the ancient paths. See, many times people approach the word of God and they say, this is antiquated. This is old school. This is, you know what, that was for their time. That was for their day. That was something for another generation. But you know what, they don't really deal with what I deal with. They don't really know what I'm going through. They can't be encountering the same problems that I'm encountering. But let me tell you something. The Bible says that there is nothing new under the sun, that what they dealt with in Jesus' day is what we're dealing with today in our day. You guys are looking at me like I don't know what I'm talking about. Oh, let's take something, all right? Let's say, since we're so cool, since we're so new and things are so different nowadays, let's find something that's different now, okay? Let's see. Identity theft. That's a new thing, right? We would say that's new. You know, the social security numbers. Jesus didn't have a social security number. The cell phone, Jesus did not have a smartphone, right? He didn't have any of that kind of stuff. So that has to be a new thing. People stealing your information off the internet. There was no internet. That's got to be a new thing, right? Right? Would you say? Would you agree? What about Jacob? Stole Esau's identity, didn't he? Put on skins of hair, right? And put on his clothes, made his dad a tasty meal and brought it into him. And he says, this can't be, this sounds like Jacob, but come near my son. What did he do? He stole his identity. He took the things that were unique to him in order to steal Esau's birthright and his blessing. There's nothing new under the sun, guys. The word of God covers it all. That's why the Bible says thou shalt not steal, is because you should not steal your neighbor's identity, should not bear false witness, right? It's all covered in the word of God. There is nothing new under the sun. Every problem, every trial, everything that you will encounter in life is covered here in the word of God. We just need to remember it. We need to get into it so it can get into us. The last thing is this. Not only remove your foot from evil and remember God's word, but receive God's direction. This is where the rubber meets the road. Because there are many Christians that are not illiterate, but very literate in the word of God. People that could school me on the Bible, right? I've had many times, many opportunities to sit with people and talk to them about their lives, give guidance from the word of God, and many times people want to talk about their marriages, many times people want to talk about how to live a godly life. Want to talk about their issues, that sort of thing. So as pastors here, we sit down with people from time to time. We're able to carve out some time and sit with people and just encourage them in their walk with the Lord. Many times I'll have people sitting in my office that have an issue. And they'll be sitting there and they'll be describing what their issue is. And I'll say, okay, well, you know what the Word of God says? And I'll start a verse. And as I start the verse, they start to quote it with me. And they go, oh, you know that one. Oh, okay. Well, let's hear more about your problem. So we keep talking and talking about their problems some more. And then I said, well, okay, let's stop there for a second. Okay, because the word says, and I start to quote a scripture, and they start to quote it with me. And then they quote another one. And I'm thinking, okay, well, you know those ones too. Then what about this? And I start to quote another scripture, and they start to quote that one with me, and then they quote two more. And after a while, I'm thinking, what are we sitting here for? You know the word. You know what the Bible says. Here's the problem. You're not doing it. You're not receiving the direction. You're making decisions based on what you think and what you feel rather than based on what the Word of God has to say. You're not receiving the direction of God. See, this has been a problem all the way from the beginning, right? God takes Adam and Eve, sets them in a garden, says, you can eat of any, come on, any of the trees except one. In other words, everything in the entire world is open to you except this one thing. And what do? They said, we want that one. Why? Because they saw that it was good for making one wise, to discern between both good and evil, and to be like God. But listen, to be like God apart from God is to exalt yourself in pride and to fall into the snare of the devil, which they did. Remember, Eve was deceived and Adam rebelled. See, this is the problem all the way from the beginning. We think we're so cool, so smart. We've got a handle on everything. I know the word, and I'm good, and this message is so simple. Man, pastor, I could have just stayed home today and curled up in the blankets and all that kind of stuff. And yet, the Spirit of God is speaking to your heart right now and saying, listen, are you doing it? If it's so easy, then why are you having such a hard time? If it's not that tough, if living is simple, then why are we banging our heads? Why aren't we strong? Why aren't we healthy? Why aren't we effective? Why are the lame still walking around San Bernardino? Why is there people still lost in Grand Terrace? Why is Colton still having problems? Come on, somebody. Why is the church not standing up and being the church if it's so simple? Because we're not doing it. And we need to gain some traction. We need to get going on this stuff, guys. This is not meant to be a Sunday morning experience. This is a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, every day of the week thing. This should be what governs our entire life. This should change everything. Man, there should be people who walk the other way when they see us coming because they know what they're going to get. They're going to get Jesus. This should be something that just changes us so much so that we become a different man or a different woman. People should realize that we have been with Jesus because it's lived out in our lives. Proverbs chapter 3, great section of verses. I would encourage you to put them to memory. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 through verse number 8. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, many of us could quote, many of us have memorized this. Say it with me if you have. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Let's stop right there. See, many times, we understand things based on our background. We understand things based on the way we were raised. Well, I'm doing marriage that way because that's the way my parents did marriage. I'm going to do finances this way because my uncle was a businessman. I'm going to go out and I'm going to live my life because that's the way of society. That's the way I was educated. That's the way I was trained. And we base our lives off of our understanding, our experience, our knowledge, rather than basing it off the Word of God. But here the Word of God flips the script on us, doesn't it? It says, don't make your own way because you're going to get out of the way. You're going to end up on the crooked path. But if you're going to make straight paths, then trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Look at the next verse. In all your ways, acknowledge Him and He shall direct your paths. How do we do that? In all your ways, acknowledge Him. Here's how. God, what do you say? God, what do you want me to do? God, I'm about ready to go into a business meeting here. What would you have me to do? How would you have me to do this deal? Is it fair for everybody? Is it right? Is this what you want? God may change the business deal, and it may seem like, well, God, why are you trying to hurt me? You know, I'm spending more than I should spend, but it's righteous before the Lord. See, there are things that we could do that on the earth we would say, yeah, that's good, that's fair, that's right, and yet God will be angry. Right? Here's King David. He's the king. He had his pick. He could do anything he wanted to do. So he decided he was going to sleep with a woman that was not his wife, commit adultery, and then he was going to kill her husband, and then he was going to make it right by taking her to himself as his wife. And so he figured everything's cool, right? But then you read in the Bible that it says, but this thing displeased the Lord. See, we got a problem when we're doing life and we think everything's okay, but the thing displeases the Lord. We have to receive His directions in all your ways, acknowledge Him. God, what would you have me to do? God, what does it say in your word? God, I want to hear. Holy Spirit, direct me. God, just take over the words. I'm not going to premeditate it, but Holy Spirit, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to lean on you that at the right time and the right way, when I start to speak, that you're going to take over, that Jesus take the wheel, right? You're just going to take over and you're going to start to speak the very oracles of God. Look at verse 7. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. See, we're back to where we started, aren't we? Now look at the rest of the verse, verse number 8. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. In other words, as we do the word of God, then that is the time when that which is lame may not be dislocated, but rather be healed. You will be strong and you will be healthy. You will be an effective Christian all of your days. Come on, somebody, say amen to that. That's good news. We need to trust God beyond just our eternity. Many people in church say, I trust God. I trust Him with all my heart. I'm leaning my entire eternity on Him. But then in their temporary, in their natural, in their now, they don't trust God. We have to be a people that says, God, in all my ways, everything, God, in my business, God, I trust you with my family, God, I trust you with my finances, God, I trust you with my neighborhood, God, I trust you with my witness, God, I trust you with my children, God, that they're going to turn out okay because they're disciples, taught of the Lord, and great shall be their peace and their undisturbed composure. I may not be the best parent, but God is the best parent. And God will raise them up to be who they need to be. God will take care of their hearts and lives. That doesn't negate your responsibility. You still got to do your part. Well, listen, when you partner up with God and when you trust in the Lord and lean not on your own understanding, now all of a sudden life starts to work. God makes you strong and healthy. We can choose to make a straight path for our feet. Our life does not have to be lame and weak. Come on, somebody. Many times people look at the church and they say, oh, that's lame, right? A weak. I don't want to have any problem. But no, we can be powerful, effective Christians. We can live a strong and healthy life. It takes discipline. It takes routines. It takes healthy habits. It takes getting into the Word. It takes prayer. It takes listening to the voice of God. It takes doing. It takes receiving that direction. God, I'm not going to go my way. I'm not going to lean on my understanding. God, I'm going to go your way. I'm going to go with your understanding. It doesn't look like I'm going to make it, but God, I know that you're going to take me to where I need to be. God, I give you the praise today. I'm going to lift up those weak hands. I'm going to strengthen those feeble knees, and God, I'm going to make straight paths for my feet. What did we learn today? Remove your foot from evil, remember God's word, and receive God's direction. The path to a healthy life. Can you say amen today? Amen. And God, good. Has the word of the Lord touched your life? Come on, give God a great big praise today. Hallelujah. God is so good. I want to take a couple minutes of your time, then I'm going to let you go, okay? So I'm going to ask everybody at this time, please remain seated. Okay? Everybody, don't get up. Don't walk out during this time. This is not the time to leave because your eternal life is at stake. I want to talk to you about your life. Many people in church think that they know how to get to heaven. And yet they're leaning on their own understanding rather than leaning on the will and the way of the Lord. And today I want to talk to you about the way of God to get to heaven. Sometimes people think all roads lead to heaven. That's very foolish because nowhere in the Bible does it say that all roads lead to heaven. Be like me saying all roads on the earth lead to the moon. Listen, you can drive around the earth as long as you want. You'll never make it to the moon. In the same way, not all roads lead to heaven. In fact, the Bible says wide open is the path that leads to destruction, but narrow is the way that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Today, I want to shine some light on the path for you, the way to eternal life. Some of you in this place might be thinking, well, Pastor, you know what? I don't believe in hell. I believe only in heaven, that God is good, and he's going to let people into heaven because he's loving. And he's a good God, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, when he went to the cross, opens the way for everybody, and so now we all get to go. Well, listen, while I would agree and say yes, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ opens it to everybody, not everybody makes the right choice while they're here on the earth. God doesn't just let everybody into heaven, ollie, oxen free, just get in here, it doesn't matter what your life looks like, because that's not how God operates. God loves us so much that he went to the cross and died for us. But he loves us enough also to give us the choice while we're here on the earth, whether we choose him and choose heaven, or whether we choose to reject him and choose hell. It's our choice. See, hell was never intended for you or me. Hell was made for the devil and the angels that rebelled against God. It's a place of eternal punishment and torment. And it's a place reserved for those who reject God. And God didn't want a bunch of robots that would worship him for eternity. He could have made trillions of robots that would just worship him and that's all they did. But no, he wanted free will agents who would love him in return of his love. And God expressed that love on the cross in the form of his son, Jesus. Deity fused with humanity died on the cross. God poured out the wrath of God for sin on Jesus. Our punishment doesn't have to be our punishment. It could be resting on Jesus on the cross. And yet, many people reject Jesus, and they reject God, and then they wonder why they're still going to head for hell. Here's why. Because God gives you the free will choice. You choose. Hell is a very real place. It's talked about in the Old Testament and the New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of it, and you're not going to avoid it by just ignoring its existence. You're going to have to face the reality of it. Today, I love you enough not to patty cake and play games. I love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. Some of you in this place said, well, you know what? I know that God lets good people into heaven. I think I've been good enough. My good outweighs my bad. Yeah, I used to be bad, but I cleaned up my act. Now I'm really good. Give money to charities, help out my neighbors, been nice to people in the community. I think that I'm going to get to heaven because I've really been a good person. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can be good enough to get to heaven? In fact, the Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to make it to heaven based on your goodness. Because the Bible tells us our goodness compared to God's goodness is like filthy rags, going to get thrown out. not going to make it. You cannot make it to heaven based on your own merit or your own goodness. You can't be good enough to get into heaven. In the same way, you can't be bad enough to keep you out. So you can't clean up your act. Say, well, you know what? I'm so bad, I really can't do this today. I need to take care of some things first. No, you take care of this first. Take care of your eternal life first. God opens this up. When you get God on the inside, he will clean up your act from the inside out. Today is your day of salvation. Some of you in this place said, well, you know what? You don't understand, Pastor. I've been raised in church. My parents told me you were Christians growing up. Hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or Christian as a child? Took you to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. You've always considered yourself to be a Christian. You're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu. We're Christians, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say because your parents take you to church, tell you you're Christian, that makes you Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, be baptized a Christian as a child, but you get to go to heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say all Americans get to go to heaven. I don't see that anywhere in the Bible. In the same way, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're not some other religion that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Today, come on, let's talk about your eternal life. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Some of these places said, well, Pastor, not only was a child did I go to church, here I'm sitting in church right now, and don't you see me? I mean, I consider myself to be a Christian. I'm in church. But do you think that if I said, you know what, I really like the Angels baseball organization. I would love to play Angel ball. And I went down to the store and bought an Angels uniform, brought my bat and my ball, my glove, my hat, you know, all that kind of stuff. Went down to Angel Stadium in Anaheim, sat in the dugout, said, I'm an Angel. Waited until game time. You think they'd let me play in the game because I sat in the dugout, wore the right clothes, and called myself the right thing? No, you know what's going to happen? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? Because I am not a member of the Angels organization. Same way, you can't just sit in church service, call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. The Bible says there were those who were invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb that were seated there, but they weren't supposed to be there, even though they went to the highways and byways and they brought them in. They weren't properly dressed, weren't robed with the right thing, didn't get there the right way, and they were cast out. Today, just because you're sitting in church, it doesn't guarantee you get to go to heaven. Let's talk about your life. Somebody said, well, okay, I understand that, but you don't understand. My last church I got involved, I helped out, I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible. I made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I even got a membership card to the church and taught in the Bible classes. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible, could you? Where that gets you to heaven, you help out, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. Get to teach in the Bible classes, that gets you into heaven. It doesn't work that way. Nowhere in the Bible say God is looking for your volunteer hour sheet or he's looking for a membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. It simply doesn't work that way. You say, but I know God. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know about Jesus, celebrate the resurrection at Easter, about ready to celebrate Christmas, sing the songs every year of my life. I can quote scriptures to you, Pastor, out of the Old and New Testament. I believe that that makes me a Christian. But if you'd read your Bible, you'd know that demons believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God. They're not Christians. If you'd read your Bible, you know the devil himself knows and believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. Everybody look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. Jesus was speaking to a religious leader of his day by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a good guy, did a lot of good deeds. Man, if we would have thought anybody was headed for heaven, we would have thought it would have been this guy. He held to the strictest form of the religious law of his time. When he gave his money, they blew trumpets. He was a teacher in Israel. He could quote the scripture. He could debate the scripture. Hey, how many of us could do this? He could sing the scripture. And yet this great man, Nicodemus, when he speaks to Jesus, and they're talking about the same thing about how to get into heaven. Jesus doesn't just pat him on the back and say, Nick, man, hey, I like what I see, man. You keep doing what you're doing, I'll see you in heaven. No, rather, what does he say? He says, Nicodemus, you want to enter the kingdom of heaven? You must be born again. I know. We mentioned being born again. Everybody shuts down. Ugh, I hate that. I saw that on a movie. You know what? That was on television. I read about that on a blog on the internet. You know, and I just don't want to have any part of it. Listen. Unless you have part in that, you won't have any part of the kingdom of heaven. Because Jesus said, not you should or it's an option. No, he said you must be born again. There's no other way you're going to get to heaven. Remember, I said it's narrow. There's few who find it. No other way you're going to get to heaven except that you must be born again. Now, let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, blogs, and the internet define for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible do that for us, shall we? What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit from my mouth. Pretty gross. Pretty graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again. Occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today I'm going to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to have everybody bow their heads and close their eyes. As we do that, I'm going to ask you to examine your heart, examine your life. As you do that, you'll be able to identify where you're at with God. And while you're sitting there thinking, if you realize and recognize, you know what, I need to do this. I need to give God all my heart, and I need to give God all my life. Here's what your opportunity is going to look like. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and then I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Couldn't get any easier. And then afterwards, I'm going to invite you up and we're going to pray together a simple prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. Today, if you want to be included in that prayer, get ready to get your hands up. Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, if you're watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put your cup of coffee down. Get ready, get your hand up. We're going to pray together. All right? Let's do this at this time. Everybody bow your heads and close your eyes. I want you to just consider where you're at with God right now. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Just answer that question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. If it's anything other than being born again, you're not going to make it. What if today was your last day? What if you died and you went before the throne of heaven? Would you get to stay in heaven or would you go to hell because you have rejected Jesus with your life? Today, just answer that question in your heart. If you said, I think, I hope, maybe, I really don't know. Come on, get ready. Get ready. This is your time. This is your moment. If you said, no, I know that I wouldn't make it. Come on, get ready. Get your hands up. I'm going to count to three and pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. If you need to give God all of your heart and all of your life, just raise your hand right now if that's you. Raise it up high. Thank you. There's one. God bless you. There's two. Who else today? Need to give God all of your heart, need to give God all of your life. There's two wise people already. Come on, ushers, help me out if I don't see them yet. There's three. Thank you. God bless you. Got you over there. Who else today? There's three wise people already. Come on, if that's you, raise it up high for me. Give me a little wave if I don't see you yet. There's three. Anybody else real quick? There's three wise people. Anybody else? There's four. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? If that's you, when I'm looking in your direction, just raise it up high for me right now if that's you. Listen, if you're sitting there wondering if you should do this, yeah, you should. Let's go for God today. Listen, you won't be alone, and I didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. You just got to make the choice today if that's you. Anybody else real quick? About three or four wise people already. Who else today? Need to give God all of your heart, need to give God all of your life. Anybody else real quick? Come on, let's go for God. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Listen, the Spirit of God just spoke to me. There's not three or four that need to give your heart and life to Jesus. He said there's seven. Okay? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. And if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I need you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in now and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. Now listen, don't play games with God. Don't just sit there, I'm fine, I'm okay. No, listen, lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. This is the way that you have to invite Jesus in your heart. You'll be born again. There's no other way you're going to make it. So today, come on, take a step of faith. Make smooth paths to your feet. That path leads you here to the altar today. Let's all stand and welcome them. If you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. Come on. All seven of you that need to come, you come right now. Make your way to the front. Let's welcome them as they come. Come on. Come on, no one leave during this time. Let's let them come forward. Come on. They're coming. Let's give them a hand. You can come too. Come on, you can come. This is your time. This is your moment. Hallelujah, they're still coming. Come on, come on, this is your time. Just make your way to the front right now.
Jesus, we love
anybody else?
Oh, how we love.
Wow, there's more than seven up here. Thank God that you guys responded to the word of the Lord today. It's good. Very good. All right, I want to lead you in that prayer, okay? I'm going to pray simple, short phrases, okay? I want you to repeat these out loud if you have the ability. My goodness, look at this, still coming. That's awesome. Awesome. Okay? I'm going to lead you in a simple prayer. This is not about the words of your mouth, so if you mess up on a couple of words, that's okay, all right? This is about the prayer of your heart right now. So we're going to set our hearts on the Lord. If you're watching by television, if you're watching there on the internet, wherever you're at, get ready to pray this prayer if you raised your hand as well, and you need to give your heart and life to Jesus. Everybody bow our heads once again. Let's close our eyes and say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all of my heart and all my life. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he came, that he died, and that he was raised again to life just for me. Come into my life. Forgive me of my sin. Wash me of my past. And give me a brand new start with a brand new heart. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm born again. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Yeah. All right. Listen. We want to encourage you. We want to help you out in your new walk with God. Right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel waving at you. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. He's going to give you some free information, all right? We've got some comic books for the kids that they can remember what happened today and just encourage you. Talk to you about a program we have here. Just basically a friend in church who will help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. Then he'll let you come right back out. It takes a couple minutes of your time. Your friends and family will wait for you, okay? So if you just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Love you, Pastor Joel. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.